Hello everyone, this is Diana Menezes and I am one of the expert OET tutors working for Triana International Academy, Mangalore. Today I am here in order to explain you regarding speaking. Now, speaking is one of the modules of OET which requires a little bit more, you know, effort because of the new introduction of the new criteria. Now, the prior criteria was only about the linguistic criteria, which consisted only of 5 sub-criterias. But now, along with the linguistic criterias, we have also got the communicative criterias. Why this communicative criterias came into existence? That's because the OET people, they want to judge or see your clinical skills. We being nurses, we'll be doing the role of a nurse in front of the interlocutor on our speaking examination day, isn't it? So that is why the OET people came up with one of the criteria called as the clinical skills criteria, which is basically known as the communication criteria, in order to assess the clinical skills. Now, what do these clinical skills consist of? Let's come to the point. I'll explain you each and everything in detail. Now, the clinical skills has got 5 different criteria. The first criteria is called as a relationship building. The second one is the understanding and incorporating the patient's perspective. The third one is called as providing structure. The fourth one is information gathering. And we have got the fifth one, which is giving information. Now, let's come to the first one. Now, this is relationship building. Why this criteria? Because it's nothing but the trust component of the patient. Whenever, even though when we are seeing the interpersonal relationships, the main important thing, the patient only opens up when he develops this particular trust component in you. That is why the OET examiners want to see, are you able to build this relationship with the patient? Now, when it comes to relationship building, you should focus on these 4 important things. The first thing that you have to keep it in mind, that you should be the one who starts the conversation. Now, on your examination day or whenever you're doing your speaking sessions, you should always remember that it is the role of the nurse who initiates the role play. You have to give a start to the conversation to make the patient comfortable when he is having conversation with you. The next thing is always be attentive. The patient should never get even a small, you know, even a small distraction, or he should not feel that you are not paying attention to what the patient is saying. So you should be always attentive. Another thing is that don't be judgmental. You shouldn't be judgmental. This is really very important because you cannot compel the patient to do something. Now, as you know, there are 5 rights of patients, where 2 more have been recently added by the Nanda, isn't it? So, with these 7 rights of the patient, one of the rights that the nurses forget is about the right to refuse the treatment. The patient has got 100% right to refuse the treatment. Therefore, a nurse can only give suggestions. She can give him some advice, and the patient, it totally depends upon the patient whether he wants to take that advice or no. So that is why try not to be judgmental. You cannot judge that whether it is, for example, it's the drinking habit, it is good or bad. You cannot say that, because according to the patient's perspective, it may not be something that is bad. So try not to be judgmental. Always try to be neutral. Even though it's a very jovial situation, or if it's a really very sad situation, try not to overwhelm. You shouldn't show the patient that you are having a lot of feelings than what the patient is having. So you should be trying to be non-judgmental. The next thing is show empathy. When we took the oath is of nursing, we always say that I'm going to be an empathetic nurse. But when we come into the clinical field, or when we are doing the OET speaking, we forget. So what do you mean by being empathetic? Now, being sympathetic means you step into the shoes of the patient and then you feel for the patient. That's called as sympathy. But empathy, we step into the patient's shoes, we feel for the patient, we come out of those shoes in order to give solution to what the patient's problem is or to what the patient is experiencing. That is called as being empathetic. Now, so these are the very important things in relationship building. We should concentrate, that we should know that we should start the conversation, we should be attentive, we should be non-judgmental, and we should also show empathy. The second thing comes as understanding and incorporating the patient's perspective. What do you mean by the perspective? The perspective is nothing but that emotional component of the patient. It's really very important to, you know, tactfully understand what the patient's psychological status is. And to understand that, you should do these three important things. The first thing is explore the patient's concerns and ideas. You should make sure that you ask a patient about his or her concerns. For example, if I say, you can ask the patient, if you don't mind, can you please tell me in detail what is bothering you? You are asking the patient to share his or her concerns with you. And that's a very important thing, to understand the emotional or the psychological aspect of the patient. Now, pick up on patient cues. Now, when the patient is conversating or expressing the concerns, you can understand from the patient's conversation or the interlocutor's conversation, like how the patient is feeling towards the situation or what is the agony that he is experiencing. Is he feeling happy about the situation? Is he really very sad, depressed, anxious, or is he reluctant to whatever you are saying? So all these cues are required to be understood. The next thing is relate the explanation to the patient's concerns. Now, whenever you are giving any solution or whenever you are asking certain questions to the patient, always try to relate that question to the patient's concerns. For example, the patient is in the hospital because of some fever. So whenever you are asking the question, try to relate it. You can say, if at all the case notes, the particular role play card which has been given to you has been saying that the patient is on antibiotics, you can relate this. For example, you can say that, from your case notes, Mr. John, I came to know that you have been administered antibiotics. So after the administering of antibiotics, how are you feeling now? Is there any improvement in your condition? So you can ask this kind of questions and make sure that when you're asking this kind of questions, you relate these questions to the concerns of the patients as well. Now, the third thing is providing structure. This has nothing to do with your particular role play, but it's not about the communication thing, but it is about totally about structuring of the role play. Now, when I say structuring of the role play, you have to see these three things. First thing is you have to sequence the interview. Now, you know that you will be given a background information, you will be given a setting, and then you are given task. And you should make sure that you move accordingly to the task, because the interlocutor will also be having a similar card of what your card is. So the conversation is divided, or the role play has been divided between yourself as well as the interlocutor. So it's really very important that you move according to the task which has been given to you. Make sure that you flow according to the role play that has been given. The next thing is make the topic changes clear. For example, you have finished one of the tasks and now you want to jump into the second task. Make sure that you are making it very clear to the interlocutor or to the patient or whomsoever you are talking. Okay? You should make it very clear that you have finished the particular topic or the task and then you are jumping into the next. For example, you have given an explanation. You can ask the client or the interlocutor, like, are you able to follow me? Did you get my point? Or Mr. John, I hope you have understood. Can I move further? So you are giving a clear picture to the interlocutor or to the role of that interlocutor, saying that you finished with this particular task and you are trying to move to the next task. Organize your explanations. As I mentioned earlier, when you are moving according to the task, make sure that you organize your explanations as well. Whenever the patient is asking you one particular question, or maybe as we know that the interlocutor is going to play different roles. He could be like a parent, maybe a spouse, or it could be like maybe a farm visitor, maybe a relative, maybe a colleague who has accompanied the patient to the emergency department, or it could be any other setting. We should organize our explanations according to that. We should make sure that we finish off one particular point and we explain according to the understanding of that particular patient's role. The fourth one is information gathering. Now, when we talk about information gathering, this is nothing but history collection. Now, history collection is a very, very important thing because you see, when you get the card and if your card is not saying about history collection, please don't skip taking history, because history collection is really very, very important. If you, being a nurse, want to understand what is the problem of the patient, it's really very important to collect the history. Now, you have to focus on these four important things when you're gathering the information. The first thing is minimize interruption. You know, when you're doing your role play, make sure that you don't interrupt in between, like using a lot of hummings, giving a long gaps. This could again hinder the communication and it can create a gap or a gap for understanding between your interlocutor and yourself to understand like what you exactly want to communicate, what you exactly want to collect it from the patient. Use open and closed-ended questions. Always remember, whenever you're doing your speaking or your role play, those 5 minutes of your role play, it should consist of both open-ended as well as closed-ended questions. Now, open-ended questions, when you throw open-ended questions, it gives the interlocutor a chance to explain more about his condition. If I say, for example, an open-ended question would be something like, Mr. John, if you don't mind, can you please explain me in detail regarding your drinking habit? You are giving Mr. John an opportunity to explain in detail. Maybe the interlocutor would tell you like since when he is drinking, how many shots he is drinking, maybe he has tried to quit drinking in the past. So all these things the interlocutor may explain you with your one question. And then we have got closed-ended question. Now, closed-ended questions are those questions which basically give the interlocutor only an option to say yes or no. So, for example, you are saying that, Mr. John, if you don't mind, can you please tell me, do you smoke? And Mr. John would say yes. So, this is an example for closed-ended questions. So, your role play should consist of both these open as well as closed-ended questions. Avoid compound questions. Many candidates, they really feel that why they are losing in speaking. This is mainly because of throwing compound questions to the interlocutor. Now, you should also make it very clear that you should not ask compound questions. Now, compound questions are something like you're joining 2-3 things together with the usage of and, or, and maybe like moreover, or many other, you know, connectives. Now, for example, a compound question would be like, Mr. John, would you please mind if I'll ask you regarding your work as well as your family? Now, you're asking 2 questions to the interlocutor's role, and the interlocutor may not be able to grasp both of these things, and you may get only answer for one of these things that the interlocutor has paid more attention for. So that is why kindly avoid using compound questions. Instead, use simple questions. Like you can ask, Mr. John, like, can you please tell me about your work situation? And once the patient has explained you, then you can ask, I would also like to know regarding your family. So you can ask 2 separate questions rather than asking compound questions, which can confuse the interlocutor. Now, clarify and summarize. You should clarify. For example, the patient is saying, you collected the history saying that, Mr. John, do you have pain? or you asked him like, can you please tell me the nature of your pain in detail? So maybe the patient has started to say that, you know, this pain started like 2-3 days back and so many things have happened over the time. You can recapitulize. Now, what is about the recapitulizing? Recapitulizing means you state back whatever the patient has told to you, but not everything in detail like what the patient said, but some bits of all these things and make it into your own thing. For example, Mr. John, what I understood from your conversation is that you are having pain for the past 7 days and it is really unbearable. Am I right? So you are clarifying what the history the patient has given, what you have understood is exactly the same or not. And then summarize. Summarizing is nothing but once again just recapitulizing and asking the patient like, whatever the nurse understood from the patient's conversation is actually a clear-cut information what the nurse has received. Now, the last one is giving information. Now, after information gathering, history collection, now you collected like what the patient's problem is, now you are focusing on giving the solution to the patient. That's what I said, like being an empathetic nurse. So here's the job of your empathy. Now, while you're giving information, you should keep these three things in mind. The first thing is establish what the patient knows. It's really very important that before you give any health education, you should basically know what the patient knows about this particular thing. If the patient is already knowing about it, then what is the use of giving this health education? So that is why assess what the patient knows. For example, you can ask, maybe you want to tell him regarding his smoking habit which is creating asthma. So you can just ask, so Mr. John, do you know what is the adverse effect of smoking on your health? You can ask, and when the patient says, I don't know much about it, sister, then comes the role of your health education, where in detail you can explain to the patient, depending upon the patient's knowledge level. The next thing is pause when giving information. Don't like just run up, because you see, whenever you're doing the speaking, the first and foremost thing what the examiner see is that, is your speaking as natural? So you should keep your speaking as natural as possible. You know, the role play should be something like it's happening in a natural setting. It shouldn't be like maybe you're doing a drama, which like, you know, just you're doing it for the sake of doing. No, it shouldn't be like that. So you should give pause. Pause, because we being medical professionals, we have to understand that patients will not be able to understand to that particular extent if you are continuously telling, because they are lay person. They do not know much about the medical field. So that is why once you give an explanation to one particular problem, kindly pause and then you start with the other. Encourage patient to share thoughts. For this is really very important, because you have to make sure that the patient has understood for what you are telling the patient. For example, the patient has, you are telling the patient that you are supposed to use nicotine patches or nicotine gums in order to give up smoking. So in that case, you have to ask the patient, are you able to follow me, Mr. John? Or am I very clear? And you can also ask the patient like, if you have any doubts, you can please tell me. So all these things are really very, very important. So here, when the patient's thoughts you are finding out, you should make sure that the patient has totally understood whatever you wanted to convey. So these are the five important criteria that have come into existence after the updation of the speaking criteria. So it's really very important, because nowadays linguistic criteria, yes, even though you have got a beautiful language, you have got a wonderful English language, some people still lose only because of the lacking of clinical skills. So this is about the updated criteria. For more information, please visit Triana International Academy, Mangalore. Thank you.